Sardar Sarovar project, that's also your Narmada Dam. Now, why we are talking? Because we all know the Statue of Unity, the statue of great man Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel has been erected over here. But at the same time, guys, you have to know that here there was the presence of Magar, crocodiles, and they were removed from this place. Now, the beauty is that there are three varieties of these Magars, that is, one is the saltwater crocodile, another is the Magar crocodile, and then there is Gharial. But then there is only one city in the entire world where crocodiles live in their natural habitat amongst the human population, and that's at this particular place, that is Sardar Sarovar project. Here it is, you can see this is being shown over here, and this is none other place but Vadodara. So this is something that you need to remember. Now, as you can see, this is the map of Mumbai, and you can see southern Mumbai being depicted over here, Elephanta Islands, Gateway of India. You can see all these are the areas which we like to go and, you know, visit. And in these areas only, recently, a dolphin, that is humpback dolphins, have been spotted. So remember that humpback dolphins have been spotted in these areas. And though they are known to have been found in Indian Ocean right from Africa till India, but then you should remember that they have been seen in these areas also. Maybe a question may come from here. Moving to the next place, this is the country Poland, and here we have Katowice. Katowice is a town where the Conference of the Parties of United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, that is COP24, was done last year. And it was done here, so it's very, very important. At the same time, what I would request you is not only remember COP24 because it's done recently, but look at the previous certain COPs too. Also, remember the agenda of COP24. That's something that you should always have an idea that what was decided at this particular place. Poland's capital, Warsaw, Katowice, important town where the COP24 has taken place. Now, as you all can see, no map, only a rhino is there. And why is this rhino? Because last year, second Asian rhino range countries meeting had happened. Now, when I'm saying second Asian range rhino countries, so question might be like this, that which of the following countries participated in the second Asian rhino range countries, and they may give you seven names of the countries and they ask you to find out which of them are the correct ones. So here, do remember who are those countries and how many were they. So totality, there were five countries who had taken participation in this second Asian range rhino meeting. And who are those? One being India. We have huge numbers of rhinos in our northeast. Then we have Nepal, Bhutan. These three are in our immediate neighborhood. And to our extended neighborhood in the eastern part of the world, we have two more countries, one being Malaysia and another one being Indonesia. These five countries together had come to conserve this beautiful animal. Now, these five countries, they come up to conserve the rhinos, which are usually in three species as far as the Asian rhinos are concerned, which are the three species, one being Sumatran, which is there in Indonesia and all those areas, another being Javan, again that Malaysia and Indonesia belt, and then we have the greater one-horned rhinos, which are usually found in our country. And the Sumatran one is the smallest of all the three. Now, with this only, I need to tell you areas like Kaziranga, Manas, Lakoba, Orang. These are the national parks where we keep on having the rhinos in our country. Let's move to the next place. Now, we can see the state of Maharashtra. And this is the place, that's Palghar. Now, Palghar, small district, one of the tribal dominated districts of Maharashtra. It's very close to Mumbai, and the bullet trains that are conceptualized as far as our country, they are passing through these places also. So why was Palghar very much in news last year? especially in the month of November, because in this area there was an unusually higher frequency of earthquakes that were happening. And scientists have mentioned these unusual tremors as earthquake swarm. They mentioned that this unusual phenomena is nothing but an earthquake swarm. Now, what exactly is this? Go through it. Mostly, I'll just make it very simple that it's usually a reservoir-induced earthquake. And in these types, what happens is usually these earthquakes are very low magnitude and happen in a very localized region. And it may go on for months, from days to months. It's not a very exceptional thing because it happens in many places. For example, in India, the GSI, the Geological Survey of India, says that there are 30 spots for such earthquake swarms. And even though the Deccan zone is not known for the earthquake belt, but here also it keeps on happening. Earlier, for example, in 2016, in Himachal Pradesh, Rampur, also such phenomena were seen. So do remember Palghar for this particular fact. Now let us look at another place. And here you can see we are looking at Iran. And in Iran, my focus here is Lake Urmia. This is the lake where I am focusing because it is a saltwater lake and it's already endangered. Largest lake of Iran and the second largest saltwater lake in Middle East and sixth largest in entire world. Already this lake has kept on continuously shrinking, and that's why earlier, which it used to be second largest, has now already become the sixth largest lake in the entire world. It is a Ramsar site as well as a biosphere reserve. So all these things you have to remember. Lake Urmia, very, very important. Let's move to the next one. You can see I'm on the eastern coast of our country. I'm in Andhra Pradesh, and this time I'm speaking about Kakinada. And when I'm speaking about Kakinada, you can see near it is a small island known as Hope Island, also known as Coast of Hope Island. Now, why is this famous? Because of the greater flamingos. Now, these greater flamingos, which are the birds, have been spotted in this particular island. And this island is also a part of this Koringa Wildlife Sanctuary. It is near the confluence of which great river? This is Godavari, which you should remember. Let's look at next item. And this time we are going to talk about the bunny grassland. Now, bunny grassland, what exactly they are? Let me tell you. First of all, look where we are. This is India. We are going to focus on Gujarat. This is Gujarat. We are going to focus on this area, which is Kutch. And let's see, this is Kutch. And within Kutch, this small red area, this is the area where we are going to talk about the bunnies. Now, this is the bigger map of this entire red zone that I'm showing over here. Now, guys, the thing is, here there are nomadic tribes known as Maldharis. And these Maldharis have been leaving all this area mainly because of the drought or the water shortage. Why is the bunny grassland so important? Because it is largest natural grassland as far as the Indian subcontinent is considered. Very, very important fact. Do remember, largest natural grassland I am talking about. Within this, there is a very big freshwater lake also known as Chari Dhand, and it's a very prominent feature of this particular place. Let's again come to northeast, and this time we are talking about Kaziranga National Park. And why we are talking? Because it's been divided into two divisions. One division, that is the existing eastern Assam wildlife, and a new division has been created, which whose name is Bishwanath Wildlife Park. So just remember, if there is any question, where is this Bishwanath Wildlife Park? Do remember where it is. It is the half of the Kaziranga Park only. As you can see, this river is passing through midway of this. So usually south is Kaziranga, north is the Bishwanath division. And this thing you have to remember. Nobody would ask which is north south, but do remember that this new national park that's been created is no other place but the same Kaziranga being divided. Now we have come to the state of Nagaland, and Nagaland we are talking because of this particular district called Mon. Why we are talking? Because the government of Nagaland has recently declared this particular area having a wildlife sanctuary known as Singpan Wildlife Sanctuary. It's an elephant reserve and is strategically, you know, linked with many other reserve forests of the neighboring state of Assam, like your Abhaypur. So let's move to the next place and we can come to the country Maldives. Now, why we are talking about Maldives in the environment area? Because world's largest 3D printed reef has been established here. Three-dimensional printed reef being established here. This 3D structure has been created in ceramic and it has been done so as to preserve or help in the preservation of the natural reefs in all these areas. Let's move to the next area. You can see I'm again talking about one is Maharashtra, and this place we are talking about the southern parts of our country. Now, why I'm talking about these two? Number one, look at here. This is Buldhana district where you have this red spot. This is a place famous for a very, very important lake. I hope you all understand by now which particular lake I am referring to. Of course, we are referring to the Lunar Lake. Now, why are we referring to this and not only that, to even places like St. Mary's Island and all? Because UNESCO Global Geopark Network status are being granted to these places. Now, understand, the Geological Survey of India, that is GSI, they chose the heritage locations in the states of Maharashtra and Gujarat for this UNESCO Geopark Network site status. Remember, presently India does not have any single entry also in this thing or in this category. But then for the first time, GSI has selected two of these locations, one being Lunar Lake, another being St. Mary's Islands. Now here, I would request you all that you should have an idea about the Global Geoparks Network, GGN, which is a legally made or constituted not-for-profit organization. And at present is having around 140 sites across 38 countries. And India is getting the entry through what? First being the Lunar Lake. Now, the importance of Lunar Lake is it is the oldest meteoric crater that's been formed on the surface of the earth. Remember, I'm talking about oldest meteoric crater across the world, not India. That is, a meteorite had come, had fallen and had crater-like thing as far as this area, Buldhana, is concerned. This is around 50,000 years old phenomena and this has been created in the basaltic rock. And one of the only of its kind as far as basaltic rock anywhere in the world is concerned. At the same time, you have the St. Mary's Islands. There are important beaches like Malpe Beach here in Karnataka. And they are very, very close to the town of Mangalore, to the town of Udupi, Manipal. These are, you know, the islands where our geological past shows that this is belonging to that region when the greater India had broken away from Madagascar, the country which is very close to Africa and is a part of the continent Africa. So it is related to that. Already was a National Geo Heritage Site, now being awarded this particular status too. Do remember both of them, Buldhana district and St. Mary's, very, very close to Udupi, Manipal, Mangalore, etc. Let's move to the next. And you can see I have taken this animal and he or she is none other than otter. And why I have taken otter? Because otters recently, they are of course being threatened as are numerous other animals in the entire world is concerned. Their populations are being threatened. Their habitats are being destroyed, destructed. Poachings are happening. Illegal trades are happening. But then India is trying to preserve or protect these animals. One of those things that we have done is the state of Uttar Pradesh has already started the census of this particular animal, which is, you know, hunted by many nomadic hunting tribes. At the same time, you can see this particular map of ours, which is showing Karnataka state. You can see places like Hospet, Hampi, because in this area, first ever otter reserve has been established in India, that's in Karnataka. It is the Tungabhadra Otter Reserve Sanctuary. Here only in these areas, the Tungabhadra Otter Reserve Sanctuary has been established. Let's move to another place, and we are going very, very far east this time. And again, we are talking about some conservation activities going on in the small island country of Palau, which is in the north of Australia, to the north of even Papua New Guinea. And what are we exactly talking about? Look at this particular lake and look at these. The country, the small country of Palau, they have banned a special sunscreen. And why they have banned? To preserve the coral reefs. Why? Because it was found that in this jellyfish lake of Palau, there was widespread sunscreen products. And that's why it was already given the tag of UNESCO World Heritage Site. And now they have banned, so that, you know, what happens is that these jellyfish are not hurt, they are not affected, and they be preserved, they be saved. This lake is nothing but the jellyfish lake of Palau, already, as I said, a UNESCO World Heritage Lake. Now, one of the beautiful aspects of this lake is it's a meromictic lake. That is, I'm again mentioning it, meromictic lake. That is, one layer of water doesn't intermix with the another layer of water. They don't intermix. So it's known as meromictic lake. It is also known as Ilmark Lake. That is Ilmark Lake. Now let's move to the southern Indian state of Kerala, and very, very rich as far as biodiversity is concerned. And here a recent discovery has been made for the Sri Lankan frog mouth. Now, it's a very rare bird, of course, the name being Sri Lankan frogmouth, and it's been discovered in a wildlife sanctuary in the Western Ghats, name being Chinar Wildlife Sanctuary. It's in Western Ghats, and this sanctuary is found in the place that's Idukki. Guys, you can also have a look at the different rivers that pass through here, because Chinar itself is a river which, you know, flows through Kerala. Let's move to the next one, and this time I am in the northeast of our country in the state of Manipur. And this time you can see India, this is Manipur, and within Manipur we are going to talk about a lake. Already a question has been asked on this particular lake in 2016 prelims examination. This lake is nothing but Kebul Lamjau National Park, Manipur. And we are talking about the Loktak Lake. Now, why we are talking about? Because hog deer. Scientists have discovered that there are subspecies of hog deer which are found in this particular national park. And as we have already said, that they rely on the fumdis that are there in these particular lakes, that is Loktak. And it's a very, very important site as far as northeast of our country is concerned. Let's move to the next. Now we are going to talk about the Blue Flag Beach. Now exactly what it is, go through it, look at it. The thing is, the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, they have identified or shortlisted some 13 blue flags or blue flag beaches all over the country. And as you can see, this particular diagram, these beaches are in Odisha, Maharashtra, Goa, Puducherry, Daman Diu, Lakshadweep, even Andaman and Nicobar Islands. And all these beaches, they need to satisfy some 33 standards, which may be of water quality, safety, environmental education, information. Different such things are there. Now, if you look at all over the world, there are over 4,000 such beaches in 49 countries. So there, if you look, we are at very small number. And you can see just an example of Spain, one in every six beaches with blue flag status worldwide are nowhere other than Spain. As far as India is concerned, I've mentioned the states and the UTs where they are, but do remember a few beaches name. For example, the Chandrabhaga beach of Odisha. That was the first beach to complete the tagging of this particular certification. Apart from this, there are other beaches like in Maharashtra, we have the Chivla beach, we have the Bhogave beach, then other beaches are of Daman's beach, there are beaches in Andaman and so on. Let's look at another one. Again in Western Ghats, a rare spider has been discovered in fact, to say rediscovered at Wayanad Wildlife Sanctuary. Very, very important discovery because the female specimen was spotted for the first time. Move to the next one. We have come to the state of Tripura in our northeast. And why we have come? Because here, pineapple, the queen pineapple has been declared as Tripura's state fruit. Guys, why I'm telling you all this? Because again, in 2016 prelims, they had asked about something, a fruit being discovered in which part of the country in Northeast, Western Ghats, Andaman, and such options were given. So we should have an idea about these. At the same time, do remember this queen pineapple has been already granted the GI tag, that is geographical indication tag, in 2015 itself. And the prominent thing is Tripura is one of the largest pineapple growing states as far as the entire country is concerned. So this was certain important places from the perspective of environment. Now let's certain places important from the perspective of international relations. Now you can see I have come to Yemen, and below Yemen we have an island called Socotra. Why I'm talking about this? Because Indian Navy had launched an operation to bring back the Indians who had stranded in this particular island. When a cyclone whose name was Mekunu had struck this particular place. Socotra is a small island, you can see, near the Arabian Sea, near the coast of Somalia, below Yemen. And what was the name of this operation? This is something that you should remember. Operation's name is Nistar. Do remember this. Moving ahead, you can see I have reached this time to Hungary. And why I am to Hungary, I'll tell you. Because along with Hungary, do remember also one more name, USA. These are the only two countries in the United Nations member states who have not agreed to a global compact for migration to better manage the international migration. So remember, if there is any question as far as, you know, that which all UN nation state members or member states have, you know, signed this, do remember everybody has signed if they are a member of UN, except for two UN members, that is US as well as Hungary. And that's why I have taken Hungary with its capital at Budapest. This was done under which declaration? That also you should remember, the New York Declaration, the name of, you know, this agreement was, which was enacted for the refugees and migrants to ensure their safety, dignity and human rights and etc. Let's move to the next one, and I have reached South Africa because last year here 10th BRICS summit was organized. Which place in South Africa? Johannesburg. Now guys, the theme of the summit should be remembered, BRICS in Africa, collaboration for inclusive growth and shared prosperity in the fourth industrial revolution. Very big, you know, theme of the summit, but do remember it was done there. At the same time, when we look at South Africa, do look at a landlocked country within South Africa known as Lesotho. At the same time, also remember Swaziland appears to be landlocked, but not entirely in South Africa because it has some borders with Mozambique also. So do remember, only one country here, Lesotho, is totally landlocked within one other country, that is South Africa. Moving to another topic, let's start with South Africa only, because last year our Prime Minister during this summit had come to South Africa, and along with South Africa, he had also visited two other places, one being Rwanda, another one being Uganda. You can see Rwanda and Uganda. Now, the thing is, Mr. Modi's visit to Rwanda was the first bilateral tour by any Indian Prime Minister to this particular country. While with regards to Uganda, it was the first one since 1997. Now, this is clearly showing the importance that we place as far as these African countries are concerned. You already know that Rwanda in the last few years, especially since 90s, when the civil war in the country had stopped, has been progressing rapidly. At the same time, Uganda is presently the chair of the East African Community. So all these are very, very important facts, and that's why these countries are important as far as India's hopes and India's aspirations of Africa is concerned. Here I would mention one more small program called Giryanka program. Under this, what happens is in Rwanda, what happens is, let's say family has been gifted a cow When this cow gives a calf, that family has to give that calf to its neighbor. So what happens is through this, you know, brotherhood is there. Now this calf should be a female calf, do you remember? So that, you know, it continues. It would transform the livelihoods, and that's why India had gifted 200 locally bought such cows to one particular village for this particular scheme, that is Giryanka. What is the village name? The village name is Weru. R-W-E-R-U. This particular village in Rwanda was gifted 200 cows under the scheme of Giryanka. Now, we have come to North America, and my focus here is Hawaii. You all would have studied about Hawaii when it comes to how the geological phenomena have constructed this particular place. But then, here my idea is that Indian Navy had last year participated in the 26th edition of RIMPAC. Now, RIMPAC, we all know, is Rim of Pacific. You can see Rim of Pacific Multinational Naval Exercise. And many new countries had for the first time participated in the RIMPAC last year, which is the world's largest set of international maritime war games. One of the notable absentees was China, which was disinvited last year from the participation in this, mainly on account of China's military actions in South China Sea. So do remember, RIMPAC did not have China last time. Moving ahead, and you can see I've come to Nepal, because Nepal had in Kathmandu, in its capital, organized the fourth summit of BIMSTEC last year. Now, the fourth summit was happening after almost a gap of 4 years. Last time it had taken place in Nai Pyi Taw in 2014. So do you remember this? Now another conference, and this time it's in Vietnam's Hanoi. This is the third edition of Indian Ocean Conference that happened last year in the capital city of Vietnam. And the theme of this was building regional architectures. So again, just remember one line, Hanoi had organized this particular conference. Next, I've come to South America, and this time I'm in Argentina. G20 summit was hosted by Argentina, the 13th one last year. And very, very important G20 summit was done because of the challenges, you know, that the world and especially developing countries are facing on account of the rising protectionism or the rising trade wars, which has led to a slowdown as far as the economic growth is concerned. So do remember, Argentina had hosted the 13th G20 conference last year. Moving next, again, I have come to Oceania, and this time I'm going to talk about the northern country of Australia, Papua New Guinea. Now, when I'm talking about Papua New Guinea, why? Because this country had organized a summit of EPEC, Asia Pacific Economic Cooperation. The important thing about this was that in this session of EPEC, no final declaration was achieved. And this was one of the aberration that is in the history of EPEC, that even after the whole session was concluded, no declaration could be done. And again, why the declaration couldn't be done was because of the tensions that were prevailing between China versus USA. Now, we are coming to Singapore in Southeast Asia. And why we are talking about here? Because India participated in the 13th East Asia Summit, which was organized in Singapore. Do you remember the East Asia Summits? They have the 10 ASEAN members. Do go through the 10 ASEAN members. All of them are here only in this particular Southeast Asian nations. And apart from these Southeast nations, there were 8 more nations which were part of this East Asia Summits. And they are, one being Australia. Of course, we were there, India. Our northern neighbor, China, was there. Our good friend, Japan, was there. That is, these are the 4 nations. Then New Zealand was there. We had Russia being part of this. South Korea was there, and finally USA. So 10 Asian members and 8 other big powers which are in this particular area. Again, I'll make it remember you, Australia, New Zealand from far Oceania, then East Japan and South Korea. We have 2 world powers, that is USA, Russia, and 2 growing powers, that is China and India. These 8 were the members of this East Asia Summit. Now we have reached the Central Asia, and here my focus would be on this particular sea, which you all should remember is Caspian Sea. And I'm going to talk about the five countries which engulf this sea: Kazakhstan, Russia, Azerbaijan, Iran, Turkmenistan. These five nations, they have come to an agreement, a breakthrough agreement, as far as the Caspian Sea's legal status was concerned. Because you have to understand, after the disintegration, you can see, barring Iran, all these were parts of USSR. What has happened was that there was a very big problem with regards to how to divide the waters, how to divide the natural resources, what about the new drillings, what about the new, you know, oil and gas fields. So for all that, you know, this particular treaty is a breakthrough treaty, because continuously, especially these three countries, Azerbaijan, Turkmenistan and Iran, had kept on contesting each other's oil and gas fields discoveries. And with this breakthrough treaty, it is expected to bring an end to this particular thing that had been, you know, going on in this particular belt for so long. Now I'm in the Scandinavian countries, and my focus here is in Sweden, on Sweden, because Sweden has become the first country in the world to launch a foreign policy manual, which is none other but a feminist foreign policy. Now, if at all in the world, anything which supports feminism was expected, it was of course expected from the Scandinavian countries, because they are far, far way ahead of all the other countries of the world. And at this point, when Sweden is bringing something of this sort, it is a huge thing, because Sweden is not only talking, but it is walking the talk that it does. Because if you look, it has already severed its ties with Saudi Arabia, mainly on account of the fact that, you know, Saudi Arabia establishes or operates a sort of dictatorship as far as the treatment of women is concerned. So while the Western European nations or the Western nations have avoided directly confronting the oil-rich state because of the money that's involved, Sweden is working on that, and its foreign policy is clearly showing what it really means to do. Moving ahead, guys, this time I'm talking about the Assumption Island in Sicily's, because this was the place where we were expected to establish our Indian naval base, but then Sicily's parliament has refused that. And of course, this is something that's setback, but then we will see what can be done here. And because Sicily's has been a very good friend of ours, and Sicily's in itself is a very good and important country because of it being the leader of the SIDS group, S-I-D-S, that is Small Island Developing States. So we have continuous ties with this, and we would continuously try to bring it that they allow us to do it. Next country, this is no other country but Mongolia, sandwiched between two powers, Russia and China. Now, why I'm talking about Mongolia? Because look at this particular province of Mongolia. Here, first strategically important oil refinery has been funded by us. What's the name of this? Dornogovi. Always remember, the province name is Dornogovi, where India has given $1 billion credit line, soft loan has been granted, and this refinery has been constructed so that the energy dependence that Mongolia has over Russia and China could be ended. Now I've come to China, and I'm talking about Qingdao. And why I'm talking about Qingdao? Because Shanghai Cooperation Organization, SCO, had its summit hosted here in this particular town. We all know India is already a member of SCO, but at the same time, you know, China is continuously trying to bring India in the Belt and Road Initiative, and we have been continuously, you know, opposing it. In this SCO summit, only last year our Prime Minister had given the secure strategy. Go through it, look at its full form, very, very important. Now again, I've come to the state of Maharashtra, and this time my focus is on Mumbai city. And Mumbai city, because here the third annual meeting of AIIB was organized. AIIB being Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. This year, this would be organized in Luxembourg. So in 2018, it was organized in Mumbai. In 2019, this summit would be organized in Luxembourg. I hope you all have idea about AIIB. It's a very big bank having around 86 members, with India also being a member of it, having almost a 9% stake and 7.5% voting rights. Let's move to the next very, very important thing. We have got the Singapore, and here last year, 12th June, Singapore summit was organized between two of the big names of the world, one being President Donald Trump and another being Kim Jong-un of North Korea. They both had come together, they had sat, they had talked, which was a huge thing because it was a breakthrough which was achieved, which resulted in both the countries signing a comprehensive document. And they both of late have tremendously improved the ties as far as US Korea is concerned. At the same time, South Korea and North Korea is also concerned. Let's move to another place. This is Guam. Again, you can see in the Oceania, Eastern Pacific Ocean. And here we are talking about this because Trilateral Naval Exercise, that is Malabar 2018, was organized here in the coastlines of Guam in Philippine Sea. And who were the three players? India, Japan, and USA. Remember, this Malabar thing happens every year. India and US were doing it earlier bilaterally. And since 2015, Japan has also joined us, and that's how it has become a trilateral body. Next one, you can see we have come to UAE, and I'm talking about Abu Dhabi. Why I'm talking about? Because last year, OIC meet had taken place in this particular town, city, where our foreign minister, Madam Sushma Swaraj, had gone there and attended the 46th inaugural session of the Council of Foreign Ministers. Now, OIC, Organization of Islamic Countries, where India was invited exactly 50 years ago in 1969 for the first time, but because of the pressure created by Pakistan or the objections raised by Pakistan, we had to return, our delegation had to return midway. But then after that, a lot has changed, a lot of water has flown under the bridge, and because of small things that happened over the last few years, India was this time even invited. It all started from 2002 when Qatar had for the first time proposed that give the observer status to India. And last year in 18, when Bangladesh along with Turkey asked for restructuring of this OIC so that more non-Muslim countries can become member of this. Remember, OIC has 57 members. It's the second largest grouping outside the UN. Administrative headquarters being Jeddah in Saudi Arabia, and the theme of this year's was 50 years of Islamic cooperation, the roadmap for prosperity and development, and they had adopted the Abu Dhabi declaration. Now next is Israel, and here we are going to talk about the Golan Heights. Now already questions have been asked on this, and the important thing that happened last year was that President of US, Mr. Donald Trump, has accepted the Israeli sovereignty over these small hills or the Golan Heights. Now, these were captured from Syria in 1967 in the battle that had taken place, the Six-Day War that had happened there. And then it was captured. And though Israel had enacted laws, you know, extending its jurisdiction as far as Golan Heights were concerned, but then UNSC had said that this was null, this was void, this is illegal, and had no international legal effect. At the same time, had asked Israel to go back. But now, with, you know, US giving the sanction to it, apart from the fact that they have already accepted that Jerusalem is the capital of Israel, it is only going to complicate the matters much more. Now, the important thing about Golan Heights is, you know, it gives a strategic buffer as far as Israel is concerned with the unstable Syria. At the same time, it also acts against Iran as a buffer because of the fact that they are very close. Syria and Iran are very, very close allies. Also for Israel, it's very important because the freshwater lake that's known as Sea of Galilee, which supplies a lot of fresh water to Israel, is hardly hundreds of meters from this particular hills. So all this makes it very, very important. Again, coming to Maldives, guys, after a lot of instability for the last few years, finally Maldives has got a democratic government in the form of Mr. Nasheed. And just after, you know, he was again sworn in, he had come to visit India as his first state visit. And it is now again expected that with Malé and, you know, the entire Maldives, we would have better ties, the cordial relations as it was pre his eviction in 2012. Now, those who don't know about Indo-Maldives relations, do study how did all start to unravel. Also look for other things of the past as far as our ties like Operation Cactus and all is concerned. Moving next, we have something that's the strategic petroleum reserves. Now, why we are talking about this? Because the Visakhapatnam Strategic Petroleum Reserve facility was operationalized last year. Now, remember, there is already three: Visakhapatnam, Mangalore and Padur. You can see Padur and Mangalore here in Karnataka, Visakhapatnam in Andhra Pradesh. One more is being planned in Chandikol, that's in Odisha, and Padur will have another one in Karnataka only. So do remember these certain names, even if you forget their what is the, you know, amount that they can store, that is okay, but do remember which all places we have the strategic this petroleum reserves. Now, as the name suggests, what happens is they are for strategic purpose, that is the crude oil is stored, and this would be, you know, as a cushion in the future if there is any external supply disruptions. And most of these are done in their natural places, that is in rocks and all, these are stored. And this reserves which are in the underground rock caverns are, as you can see, on the both east as well as the western coasts of our country. So this is very, very important. Apart from this, there is also talk about having such reserves in Bikaner and Rajkot, that is in Rajasthan, and in Gujarat also there are talks for this. Moving ahead, now this is old thing, new thing is Chabahar became operational last year. Gwadar is there in Pakistan, we know, and this is very, very important because with Chabahar being operational, we can use this port to enter in the hinterland of Central Asia and also support Afghanistan without being, you know, totally dependent on Pakistan, though they have never supported us. At the same time, you all should know the Zaranj Delaram highway, which has been constructed in Afghanistan. And also, again, it's an old topic, but you should have an idea about the International North-South Transport Corridor, INSTC. So all these things are something which are old, but because Chabahar became operational last year, it was in news. Let's move to the next one. And this time we are coming to Chagos Archipelago and Diego Garcia. Why it is in news? Because International Court of Justice has said that Britain should hand over this particular place back to Mauritius, whereas British government is rejecting this particular suggestion of ICJ, saying that they don't have any locus standi as far as this particular area is concerned. Remember, Diego Garcia is very, very famous for the US base. And this is one of the Chagos Islands, because there are a chain of the different islands. One of them, it is a very small atoll where this particular US base is there. Moving ahead, you can see we have come to the Central Asian countries and remember their capitals. At the same time, do remember that one of these, that is Samarkand in Uzbekistan, last year organized the first India Central Asia dialogue, now which is very, very important, chaired by Madam Sushma Swaraj. Now we all know these Central Asian countries are very, very important with regards to India, and India wants to have better relations with all these countries, and that's why historically day one onwards we have been very supportive of them. We recognize these countries, and of late we have had better relations with them. For example, uranium is being imported from Kazakhstan in huge quantity, then gold is being imported from Kyrgyzstan. So all this is happening. You all also know with regards to the Tapi, that is Kazakhstan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and then going inside India, the Tapi pipeline also has been proposed, that's starting from Turkmenistan and would be ending at Fazilka, that is on the Pakistan-Indian border. So all this is there, so do remember about Central Asia. Let's move to the next, and as you can see, we have now reached India, and within India, we are talking about Andaman and Nicobar Islands, where the Indian Navy has commissioned a new airbase known as INS Kohasa in North Andaman. It's almost 100 miles north of Port Blair. This is the fourth airbase and the third naval air facility in this Andaman and Nicobar archipelago. And earlier we had airstrips at Port Blair. In Campbell Bay, we had INS Baz, and in Kar Nicobar, we have an Air Force base also. So all this is there. Along with that, the fact is, it is the only place where India's Tri-Service Command is there. Lastly, let's look at one more, again in Andaman, because Prime Minister had renamed three of the islands. And as you can see, these islands, Ross Island being named after Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose Island, Havelock Island named as Swaraj Deep, and Neel Island named as Shaheed Dweep. These three islands were renamed, giving tribute to Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose, at the same time also giving tribute to Azad Hind Fauj. Lastly, in Andaman only, last year, you all know, there was an American adventurer, John Chow, who had been killed at the hands of the local inhabitants in an island that is the North Sentinel Islands. So you can look at this also. So this was the discussion about the geography through map. And what we have talked, as I said at the very beginning, that we would be talking about only those areas which have been in news in the last 1 year. And I've comprehensively covered more than some 80 places in this particular discussion. I hope, sincerely hope, that some questions come from this area. At the same time, my request to you people would be that go through our other geography through map discussions of the last year, where we have already discussed the static areas, and they are available on the YouTube. Go through them, and if you need anything, you can post it on the comment section. Any more things that you require with regards to geography through map. If you want the slides of this, that is the maps that we have done, that also will be provided to you. The link would be given. Go through that. And this was all from our side. The best of luck is there for all you people. We would like as many students to clear the prelims exam. And we would hope that BYJU'S IAS was really instrumental in a small way through geography, through maps, in helping you clearing this exam. That's all for the day. Thank you. Goodbye.